Welcome to our Thursday, March 2nd, 2017 regular meeting of the school committee. If everyone would rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Great. I will take a quick run through our short agenda this evening. We have recognitions, our first opportunity for public comment, reports to the school committee from the student council, our liaison reports, our school committee chair report, our superintendent's report, and a school lunch report. And we have no new business this evening, and under old business, we have FY18 capital project request discussion, as well as a turf field design request for qualifications discussion. Our second opportunity for public comment, and then our items by consensus, and then adjournment. And at this time, Dr. McLeod, I'd ask if there are any recognitions this evening.
So we were hoping that we would have science fair recognitions, but given that it just happened yesterday, we will look forward to having them, the finalists, here at our next meeting.
Okay, great.
So not tonight.
Then we have our first opportunity for public comment, which I don't believe there's anyone from the public here at this time. So we can move on, Dr. McLeod, to reports from the school committee, or sorry, from student council. And I know we have Sarah Durr and Olivia Spar with us tonight.
Thank you.
Oh, okay. Hi, I'm Olivia. So we have a few new things for this meeting. So tomorrow we have 32 Japanese students coming to visit the high school. This wasn't something we were totally expecting, but Ashland High School was scheduled to have them come, but unfortunately a student in their town passed away, and the services for him are tomorrow, so we volunteered to help them out since they're our neighbors and they deserve that. So we'll be having them come in, and we met today with Mr. Bishop, and Student Council and the Ambassadors Club are going to be guiding them along the day. So we're all really excited to meet new people and bring them along for a day here. And then at the end of the day, we are also going to gather in the library, and they have a video prepared for us of what their school is like, so we get a taste for their culture as well.
Can I just jump in there
by
saying that I was interviewing Mr. Bishop today on the Highlights for the Hill show, and he just commented that, you know, even though it was unexpected, and with everything else you have going on, he had 60 students just volunteering to be able to help out with this. And I just want to commend you for that, because we know what your days are like and how many things you're balancing, and it should be understood that this was not a small undertaking for you to take on. So thank you.
Thanks. And then so next week we have a busy week as well. Monday night is spring sports athletics night, so Miss King will be organizing that and letting all the athletes know what to be expecting. On Thursday we have a college mini fair, and this is different than we've done in the past. So in the past it's been in the fall, but now obviously it's in March, and it's going to be just for sophomores and juniors. So kind of getting them involved in the college process early on. Next weekend, Thursday through Saturday, is the school play. I believe it's called An Enchanted April, so it should be great. They always are. And then Friday the 10th is going to be a half day, so we'll have a modified schedule.
And then also our boys hockey team and girls basketball team started playoffs this week. The hockey team had their first playoff game last night, and they won against Silver Lake 9-1, so they're playing Saturday night. And then girls basketball is playing tomorrow night at 7. And so I know we are all going to support them, and there was a lot of people at the hockey game. And then tomorrow we have all 7 periods, where usually in a rotation we only have 5 a day. But for the younger classes, for like freshmen, sophomores, juniors, they wanted to meet with all their students tomorrow to get recommendations for next year. So it'll be a bit of a packed day, but I think it'll be interesting for the Japanese students, especially to see all our classes. And then also the BPA, or Business Professionals of America, state competition is in Framingham with Mr. Scott, And if they do well at this, they could go to nationals. So we're excited about that.
Yes. Is there something going on tonight? A game or something? Because we were surprised at all the cars.
There's the indoor track banquet in the cafeteria.
Oh, yeah. There you go.
Yes.
Thank you.
Always something going on.
Yeah.
So, I think that's all we have for tonight. So.
Great.
Thanks so much
for being here. Thank you.
Always stay warm.
Yeah. We'll be excited to hear about the Japanese students when you come back next time.
Yeah.
So now we have our opportunity for liaison reports. I don't know if anyone on the committee has any reports that aren't going to be dealt with later.
Yeah, I have one from TURF, but I think it makes sense to do it.
Okay.
When we talk about the RFQ.
Elementary School Building Committee, we just scheduled our next meeting. It's going to be on Monday, March 20th. So nothing else significant to report with respect to that.
And I know that the next CPAC meeting is on Tuesday, March 14th at 7. I actually won't be able to attend because we will be interviewing finalists on that day. So, which I guess can lead me right into the chair report, which is the Director of Finance timeline update. So originally the school committee had planned to interview the Director of Finance and Operations finalists on March 16th, and we have moved up our timeline a couple days to March 14th at 6 p.m. here in the high school library. In order to move the process along for our candidates, as well as to allow us more time since our agenda is quite a bit packed on the 16th. So that is the new timeline, and we will have a press release sent out to the town tomorrow. And the I don't believe there was any other we had a communication on the naming of the school. So, which actually, we're going to talk about that next. I'm like, why is that on the agenda? So we had one of our citizens of the town send an email to Dr. McLeod. Actually, I didn't receive it. Dr. McLeod forwarded it to me about one of the final candidates, and I'm forgetting the name. Pratt? Is it Pratt or was it?
Either Marion Harris or Mary Pratt.
I thought it was Amy Phipps.
I think, you're absolutely right.
What did she say?
Amy Phipps. Amy Phipps.
Okay, sorry, it was Amy G. Phipps.
So the message from the citizen was that they didn't necessarily feel that the biography that was provided in the survey and in any of our information that we posted was complete enough to give people a full representation of the importance of Amy Phipps to the community and the education system within Hopkinton, and proceeded to fill us in with more information. I don't have a copy of that with me right now, but so obviously we're way past the deadlines of the survey and all of that. What we did respond back was that we provided the information that was provided by the person that nominated Ms. Phipps, and that was all the information we had at the time. So while we thank the person for providing us more information, which obviously is helpful for all of us, and had that been forwarded to everyone on the committee? I'm sorry, I'm not remembering.
Yes, it
okay.
was.
So everyone on the committee has that in light of the fact that we will be getting a recommendation tonight for Dr. McLeod and being able to personally deliberate ourselves in our own heads as to what we're feeling for the naming of the school, because our next meeting it'll be decision time for the school committee on that. But I just wanted to make everyone aware publicly that we had received that feedback in terms of Ms. Phipps' recommendation, and make sure you had that information. Otherwise, it's been relatively quiet, and I haven't had much other communication from the public at all, and so that was it. And now, Dr. McLeod, your turn for your report tonight.
So my report is really going to encompass the recommendation for the new elementary school. And I wanted to frame my recommendation around what I know to be true about little people. And that is that their world revolves around their neighborhood. And to the point where Lauren will come and tell us stories about how kids will be talking about where they live and be really surprised to learn that the child sitting beside them lives in Hopkinton too. So that was really the lens that I brought. I think it's really important that our youngest learners have a connection to the name of their building. And it has been emotional. I mean, as Lori had pointed out, this is a really important decision. So as Lori compared it to naming a child, I think the process has been so embraced by the community, and there's been so many people that have worked collaboratively on this project to be at the place where we're ready, almost ready, for a name is just another step forward. And so I really don't take this recommendation lightly. I think your process has been really well thought out and guided by policy. And I know that all of the recommendations came from people who care deeply about the recommendations that they made. Part of what you wanted to do in addition to policy was to send out a survey. So that was above and beyond what policy dictated. And as you know, there were almost 3,000 responses. So awesome. People care. And as we also know that this was going to be some of the information that you would be considering in making what's going to be a very difficult decision. My recommendation, for all of the reasons that I just stated, is for the new school to be named Marathon Elementary School. In addition to the children being able to relate to that, they know that the marathon starts in their town. They know that from a very young age. But the idea of it all starts here, and the way that message also applies so well to the beginning of their educational experience, of their entire educational experience, other than obviously what they've learned at home and in private preschools and daycares, is really, really significant to me. And there was, just so you have all of the information, 27% of the votes were for that school, a close runner-up, or the closest runner-up at 19%, was for Hayden Row Elementary School. So I thought long and hard, and as I've already said, it was a very, very difficult decision. But because I want or would recommend, my recommendation is that we have a school whose name is most meaningful to the students who attend it. My recommendation is that the new school be called Marathon Elementary School.
Thank you. Did anyone have any questions for Dr. McLeod on the recommendation?
Okay. No, it sounds like that was the clear front runner of the survey.
Yep, 19. Yep. The next runner up at 9% was Thomas Arger. Am I saying it
yes.
right now? Thomas Arger Elementary School. Sorry, Lorette Danahy was 9.9, and then Thomas Arger was 9.1. Again, we know that every recommendation came from a place where people felt very deeply about the individuals. We heard from many veterans that it be called Veterans Memorial Elementary School. And, right, it's just a very difficult decision for you to have to make.
Thank you. All right, just so you all are aware, we will have this on our next meeting's agenda for us to make our final decision and name the school. All right. So anything else, Dr. McLeod?
Nothing tonight.
Okay.
Thank you.
Our next item on the agenda is our school lunch report, which we're running a little bit ahead, but I believe our guests of honor are here.
It seems like bad luck to say we're running ahead.
I know, but...
I know.
So, I'm sorry if I pronounce last names wrong. Joe Armenti?
Yes.
And Kevin Welch are here to join
Correct.
Us this evening. Thank you.
Welcome.
Nice to see you.
Nice to see you. Good. How are you?
Good. By way of introduction, because I don't know if Nancy has ever met the individuals.
Hey, Nancy.
I don't believe I have.
Our food service
it's nice
director.
To meet you.
Nice to see you.
Nice to meet you.
That's okay.
It's okay.
It's just a nice wave.
So we're sure that you've had an opportunity to review their report, and the guys are happy to answer any questions you might have. I've asked them tonight to focus their attention on the financial piece. I will point out that the last paragraph of the report I had a lot of input on, because Joe felt a little uncomfortable making a comment about our revolving account. Okay. But I took some editorial liberty there.
It sounded like you when I read it.
It did. Okay.
Thank you.
So with that, I'll turn it over to Joe and Kevin.
Great. Okay.
Thank you for having us tonight. And like Ralph says, we're just here to answer any questions that you may have on the report. Just to give you a quick overview of the financials so far through January, overall the revenue compared to last year through January is about the same. We're about $3 a day lower than last year. A la carte sales are higher this year than they were last year. The Type A meals are a little bit lower. Revenue's lower on the meals. We're doing less meals, and the majority of those meals are really at the high school that we're doing less from year over year. And also breakfast. We've had a dramatic impact in breakfast at the high school, and we feel that's probably due to the juniors, the new privileges that they have to come in later. So we're actually doing about half as many breakfasts as we did last year. Labor's down a little bit compared to last year. We've had some changes in labor. Also, we've been able to reduce someone at the high school, not replace a part-timer at the high school. And our product cost from last year to this year has remained the same percentage-wise, which is good. We've got some new equipment at both middle and the high school, and we've got some ideas, especially a large salad bar, to try to get more meals, more participation at the high school to get that back on track. And that's it. If anyone has any...
If I could, I'd like to just make the comment that to not underestimate the impact that Hiller Days has on the breakfast program and the privileges.
I was thinking about that.
Yeah, it's not an excuse. It's a fact of life.
Yeah.
And the program, does get impacted when students can come in late or come and go.
Yeah.
So everybody knows that it's all a great idea. You know, it does reduce the stress for the students and that sort of thing. But just bear that in mind.
Unintended consequences.
Yeah, because what happens is they come in later, and then they're eating at 11 or quarter of 11, 12. So if they're coming in later, they're probably already have eaten. So just have lunch an hour later doesn't seem to work. And then they're going to be able to go home earlier at 1. Doesn't make sense to eat. So we're trying to see if we can customize the program a little bit more, where we've added a larger salad bar for hopefully those kids that maybe will come down and get a salad to go, wraps to go, things like that to maybe take home for lunch.
Can you bring in Starbucks?
Well, we see a lot of Starbucks come in.
Yeah, I know.
With the late arrivals and the early dismissals.
Yeah, we're not allowed to sell caffeinated beverages.
Oh, what a shame.
So. Yeah. Huh?
Yeah. Good for the teachers, not too good for the students.
Yeah.
I did hear that and I saw in your packet that the trickle down is that the middle school now has a better salad bar as well.
Yes, we took the salad bar that was at the high school, brought that to the middle school, so they'll have a larger selection.
Right.
And the we also got another piece of equipment to add to the deli there. So it's a cold well, so we'll be able to expand the Coyote Grill, which is a Mexican concept, as well as add to the Boar's Head deli there. So the kids will have more variety, almost like a Subway there.
Yeah, more toppings.
More toppings and things.
Stuff like that, yeah.
So,
yeah. And it gives our workers actually a little bit more space to roam freely too and do a few more things behind the counter. So it's a win-win.
So I would just say, I think, I mean, that the highlight of me for this, for me, of this report every 6 months or so, whenever we do it, is in hearing those improvements that you're constantly making. I mean, this doesn't resemble the cafeterias that I remember having in school in any way, shape, or form. But I'd also be remiss if I didn't point out that we know that over the last couple of years, there's been a lot of community feedback
mm-hmm.
around the offerings. And I know that at the end of last year, we talked about, Kevin, how you partnered with some members of the community to,
yep.
to really try to find some solutions to what they were requesting. And I did note that that continues to be shown in these highlights in terms of the increase of non-GMO foods, organic foods. I know this isn't an easy solution, and so I just want to say again that I think the community really appreciates the partnership that we've seen from Whitson's to try to respond in a smart way to what the community is asking for. So that is much appreciated.
Yeah, and we think there's more to come in the future. Whitson's Corporate is constantly looking for healthier options, non-GMO foods, no high fructose corn syrup, more organic offerings. So there's more to come on that, I believe.
Great.
Absolutely.
I mean, I certainly agree with what John said. I think it's evident that you every time you come here, you have new programs that you've introduced that you've tried. And so I like that you're always evaluating what you're doing. But I also wanted to take this opportunity, since we haven't seen you for a little while, also to sincerely thank you for your response to the lead in the pipes and
how far above
and beyond with the call of duty that you went to respond to that. I mean, immediately and in a much more significant way than was actually even required. And so, I mean, to me, it didn't really surprise me, but it just validated that you really have the health and well-being of our kids at the forefront of the decisions that you're making. So I wanted to personally thank you for doing that as well.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate that.
She stole my thunder on the lead pipe.
Sorry.
So that's, I echo it completely, because that was the one thing I was hoping to be able to thank you in person for, because we really, certainly all of us appreciate it, with all of us having students in the buildings that are impacted by that. But I didn't
We're
have any
parents as well, so we get that.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah.
I didn't have any additional comments on the report. Everyone's highlighted the areas that I thought were very impressive as well. The only thing I can think of about in terms of increasing use of the services is that I do think, and I know this personally, that there's somewhat of a stigma out there for parents to not pack their kids' lunches and to send them to school to get lunch. And so I don't know if there's any way to how better to message to parents about what, because I don't even know about all those changes that you're implementing until we see your report. So it may make sense to try and find some way to update parents on what food services is doing on an ongoing basis, to maybe change the misconception that, you know, that really their kids are only going to get fed well if they bring their lunch.
Okay.
Because I think really where it's not always what, it doesn't always start with the kids about not wanting to choose lunch at school. Mm-hmm. It may be the parents.
Right.
So that would be my only recommendation to think about. And I'm not a marketing person. I can't tell you a great way to do it, but I think that's one area that might help increase your use of the services as well.
Okay. The advocate is actually going to be doing a story too. It'll come out in the next edition.
Oh, the Hopkinton Independent.
Yeah, the Independent.
Yeah, they did interview us.
Okay.
So I've reached out to Ashok with our IT folks to to work on some email blasts to parents and potentially just send our monthly menus out at the beginning of every month to parents.
Yeah, so that
they
would
don't
be
have
great.
To look for that online. So I'm gonna hit him up again this week, and we'll see where we can go with that. But I think that's a pretty simple thing.
Well, I mean, one thing I know at the elementary level is that each of the principals do a newsletter every month.
Yeah.
And, you know, Director of Student Services has a piece in there, you know, the different areas. It may be that if you've made some changes or that things, you know, some happenings, it might be good to get a mention in those newsletters every so often so that you're highlighting it. I mean, I know as a parent I read that because it has a lot of helpful information of what's going to come up, you know, what days I need to be prepared for with my kids. So, although I will tell you that my two that are actually in the elementary system love buying lunch, so you have two very steady. You have two very steady customers on my side of the world, but that would just be another recommendation for you.
Okay, great.
So we'll be making a recommendation soon on an extension of the contract. This is the fifth year that Whitson's has been here. It's their second 3-year contract, but regulations require a renewal to be voted on by the school committee every year. So we'll be coming in a couple of weeks on that.
Okay. Awesome. We're holding all our questions about the prices for the later date.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yep, which I assume is before July 1st, right?
It is. It's April.
Definitely. Definitely. Yeah.
So does anyone else have any further comments?
No, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Great.
Thank you very much for having us.
You guys.
Appreciate it.
Thank you for taking the time tonight. Appreciate
thank you.
All right. So we've finished our reports for the evening, and we can move on to old business. Our first item on the agenda is the FY18 capital project request. We had a brief discussion about this at our last meeting with questions that we posed back to Mr. Dumas as well as to the town finance director, Mr. Sandini, and the town manager. Obviously, the four of us were all part of the joint meeting with the Board of Selectmen on Tuesday, where this was also a point of discussion. The only thing I would add, and it's not an agenda item this evening, but it's related, and we should make a decision on putting it on the next agenda or not, is, and you all might not have received the email in time before the meeting tonight, but I had asked Dr. McLeod to forward a correspondence that we received from the town finance director and the town manager this afternoon in regards to a further request that was not communicated to us during the Tuesday night meeting, joint meeting with the Board of Selectmen, in regards to our operating budget. It's not an agenda item tonight. So we will not have any discussion tonight. My only question to the committee is if you have any desire for me to put this on the agenda for March 16th date for discussion.
So what are we doing that first?
I want to do that first before we get into the capital.
I think we've gone through an extensive process in reviewing our operating budget. I think that we've been as tight this year recognizing not only the previous year's budgets where we have introduced new programs and they've been supported by the town at potentially larger increases, and recognizing that part of this increase in capital debt service this year is related to obviously the town approving the new school as well. I think we've gone through that process thoroughly. I don't see the point in opening up a discussion around the operating budget because there's no area left in it that I'm comfortable seeing cut. Quite frankly, otherwise, I think we would have cut it already. So I don't have any desire to open it up as an agenda item for the 16th.
I would echo that. I actually am a little bit surprised to see that come back. I felt like we had a very good collaborative process with appropriations and the Board of Selectmen and the town manager, and really I felt like they really understood that this was a budget that did not have extra stuff in it, that we had built it really from the ground up. We had not really seen it. One, I can't remember who it was actually said, there did not seem to be extra stuff in there. And I'm not comfortable, given that we have an increase in English language learners. We have bus increases. We have increased enrollment. I don't know how we can take away from the operational budget and maintain services for the students we have.
I feel strongly that we need to stay true to the integrity of the process that we entered into in the fall. And, you know, as part of that process, we participated, as we always do, in a joint meeting on Tuesday, and we committed to take a look at both our operating and capital improvements budget with a target number, and I'm prepared to do that tonight, but I am prepared to do that in terms of capital and not operating. So that is the request that was made to us that we agreed to. If that has changed, that either was done outside the open meeting law or not with the permission or sanction of the Board of Selectmen. And so unless and until that communication is made directly to us from the Board of Selectmen, I just think it adds chaos to a process that has already become very, very confused. In my mind at this time, the budget and capital articles are in the hands of the Appropriations Committee. I think we have to respect their portion of the process. And, you know, if a more comprehensive and I mean, I feel like at this point our budget has been well vetted. I think there was a very rigorous and thorough conversation on Tuesday that we all ended with the same agreement. This is not in the spirit of that agreement, so I absolutely do not want to ask you to put that on the March 16th agenda. If something is it changes, they're absolutely welcome at any time to come back to us. But based on what I've seen today, at the last minute, without the input of the Board of Selectmen, absolutely not.
So I greatly appreciate all of your comments on this. I feel largely the same. I have no inclination to add this to our agenda, as we were with the Board of Selectmen for over 3 hours on Tuesday night, and this was never brought up as a need, a want, a request of any sort to myself. I did not receive any kind of correspondence from the chair of the Board of Selectmen in regards to anything that we may have missed that evening. In fact, this communication didn't even come directly to me. From the town manager, the finance director. It was to Dr. McLeod and Mr. Dumas, and who kindly forwarded it so that I was at least aware, which I felt it was important for you all to be aware as well. I'm extremely uncomfortable in us even considering opening up the operating budget in light of the fact that we had our Board of Selectmen liaison, our town manager, and the chair of the appropriations with us every step of the way. We invited them to the table. They were given every opportunity to ask any questions or provide any commentary that they had on any aspect of the budget. And we opened up our entire administrative staff to those questions as well, and we were not required to do so. They have no oversight over any of those folks, and I think that actually it was a huge burden that we put on the principals to have that level of audience within a budget meeting. And so at this time, and especially in light of the comments that were made during those meetings, as how thorough those meetings were and how thorough our look at it was, I see absolutely no reason for us to take this up this time. And I truly was not given any information on Tuesday night where we were provided numbers on the budget and the public was provided numbers on the budget to even demonstrate to me why that's an ask in the first place. So we're all in agreement. We don't have to take a vote on it because at this time we're not doing anything, but I wanted to make sure you all had the opportunity to make a decision as far as our agenda is concerned, and thank you for commenting on it. So at this time we will move on to the capital projects request because we did have plans to talk about that this evening. We were provided some information on that on Tuesday night. At the time, the ask, Mr. Dumas, and correct me if I'm wrong, was $252,000. That's what was stated Tuesday night?
That's correct.
And granted, this is a request of the committee to look at what potentially we were able to take off for this year. It is not a requirement. And so I know I would open it up to the committee to have discussion on where your thoughts are in relation to the capital improvement request list that we had submitted back earlier in November, December timeframe. I don't remember exactly.
We reviewed it with CIC in December.
Right.
So it was submitted earlier than that. Yeah.
Okay.
So just for your information, the genesis of the 252, there's no real science behind it, other than that was the total of the requests, not the request, the item, the recommended items that we brought before you, I think it was at the last meeting. Mr. Kamalo knew, you weren't there, John.
No, that's not why I'm giving a quizzical look. I was there for that. I'm giving a quizzical look at that being the rationale, not
That happens
target
to be.
Cut. It was knowing what had been discussed.
Yeah, I specifically asked the question, how'd you come up with that number? And they pointed at those four items, they being Norman and Chris Sandini.
Appreciate you asking that question.
Yep.
Do capital improvements approve all of our...
Capital improvements hasn't taken any votes yet.
No. So, I don't want to go first every time, but I mean, I will. So, I'm... In the five years on this committee and prior in the Appropriations Committee, I've actually never experienced a budget process like this one. And that's causing me to really struggle looking at this list. And I'm speaking about that in a variety of terms, but the largest of which being I continue to be unclear about the need for the ask of reduction. So in the past years where we have been closer to a levy limit, we have been asked to take a hard look, and we have willingly collaborated in that regard. There have been years where we've given back some things, and when free cash was certified or state aid came in, we were given some things back in that collaborative process. What I'm struggling with is, and I'm not, I don't think any of us here at this table, again, speaking to the, as we said earlier, we went through a very rigorous process, and there are things that we did cut from this list that we did not deem as needs at this time. We're not up against a levy limit. We are up against an incredibly unique year in which the tax levy will be increasing based on excluded debt that comes from three large projects that the town approved. I disagree with some of our colleagues on the Board of Selectmen that intimated that the town didn't sort of knowingly approve these projects, knowing their impact. I think the town did approve these projects at town meeting, in almost all cases overwhelmingly, and I didn't hear anyone at town, any of those town meetings, get up to the microphone and say, I'm approving this, I'm voting yes on this particular capital article with the understanding that when this debt comes online, we need to make sure we shrink the budget. I don't think that there's anybody in town who voted for these who would be willing to accept a reduction in services or expects a reduction in services. And while I understand that there are some people who believe that it's the role of these elected bodies to keep the actual tax levy number increase in control, I think it's also largely our duty to make sure we're abiding by the will of the voters of the town who approve these projects, who knew how much they cost, and still expect a level of service at what continues to be, I think, a well-thought-out and efficient budget that was done through a transparent process. So my struggle is, on a large level, to get a request to reduce our capital requests fairly arbitrarily, I can't feel motivated to do that because I believe that the requests were done for very good reasons. If you go through each of these, they're not wants. They are items that are driven by a need, a deficiency, somewhere where our school may not be sort of on par with other competitive schools. And I think we owe it to the voters to continue to provide services at that level. So I guess I'm going to hedge minorly and say, if there are things on which the administration wants to discuss the individual merit of an article in the way that we probably always do at this time of year, I'm open to that. But in terms of trying to work to a number that has been developed arbitrarily because some members of another elected body believe that the town's voters voted for projects not knowing how much they cost, I'm not willing to do that because I don't think I'm doing my job if I do.
Trust me, you don't need to feel obligated to speak tonight. If you have nothing further to add, we don't have to. I just want everyone to have the opportunity to speak to these, this particular request. So,
you know, I think that we had a long conversation with the Appropriation Committee and the Board of Selectmen, and we agreed to take a look. I appreciate the recommendations that you've put before us. Those are the ones that I would be willing to consider moving out. However, I also am very uncomfortable because I feel like every few hours the sand is shifting beneath our feet, and we had a very long meeting and came to an agreement with two other committees. We left that meeting, and that agreement was changed without conversation, permission, input, or communication to the two committees who left. That agreement has been changed yet again via email today, minutes before this meeting. I don't feel it's responsible for us to make any decision about any of this, make any change to the very deliberative process that we've gone through until we get a little more solid understanding of what is happening here. I have been on this committee for 8 years, including a year where we had a 0.83% increase across the town, and I have never seen this level of confusion, chaos. I'm completely at a loss as to how to move forward. I think we have endeavored at every turn to be collaborative. This town has showed tremendous support for its school district for every year that I've been here, and I know that all of us appreciate that keenly, but I also know that school is expensive to pay for. You know, public school is expensive. So I appreciate that, and I'm not unwilling to take a hard look if that's what other departments are doing. But the inconsistency, just changing the rules of engagement capriciously and hour by hour, I don't think we can operate in that kind of an environment. I don't think so. I can't do it.
I think I feel a lot of what has been said. I do definitely feel the fiduciary responsibility that we have to the town. I feel like we were committed to the process and to going and being with the Board of Selectmen in a way that felt like it should have been collaborative. It felt like some of the information didn't feel like it was accurate. It feels like they're trying to make or impose from a place that isn't fully informed. Some of the things that were talked about for example, regarding the regional technical school, things that they're trying to cut that contractually can't be done. I feel like there needs to be the information needs to be accurate. We need to have confidence in the process and in feeling like we are doing the best for all of our citizens, that we are taking both the fiduciary responsibility very seriously, but also the responsibility to protect the schools and the investment that the town has in the schools, in the school system that people have moved here for. I feel like the things that we've looked at to discuss cutting are things that I'm willing to have a discussion and would like to hear more from your standpoint, what the merits of waiting on some of these highlighted projects would be, if that's a possibility. But I feel like trying to just arrive at a particular number doesn't seem like the most responsible way to do it.
So just to jump in for a second on the highlights, these are not recommendations of Dr. McLeod or Mr. Dumas in terms of what we should be evaluating to cut at this time. Okay. These were the items that Mr. Dumas was notified by the town manager and the director of finance for the town that they were looking at to come up with the $252,000 number. So these are not recommendations by the district in terms of what we want to do.
So if I may?
Yep.
This is largely what we did recommend to the school committee at the last meeting. And that the number that you just identified, John, that did come was connected in some way to what they thought was our original recommendation to you. Tonight we're not making one. But 2 weeks ago, when you felt very clearly and understandably that you were being asked to make a decision without all of the information that you were seeking, we were all hoping that we would get that information on Tuesday and come tonight feeling ready. So I just wanted to, it did come from some form of a recommendation that okay. If we were not prioritizing, but these are absolutely things that we could not in any way do without. Just
all right. So I mean I have similar feelings on this process. I don't feel it, what was the one thing that was evident to me during the meeting, at least, which I have to congratulate you, Dr. McLeod, on this, is that we come to our meetings extremely prepared in background prior to our meetings. Our packets are very thorough, and I'm not quite certain that the same happens for other board meetings in the town, because I was not understanding how some of the information that was put out by members of the Board of Selectmen in their discussion was not clear on any background information that they were received for the budget in preparation for the budget. I mean, to me, that must be one of their largest meetings that they have all year. And it appeared that they had little to no factual information provided to them, or if they did, they hadn't had time to read it. I think a lot of us felt like we could have jumped in at times to even correct some of the misinformation, but it wasn't really our place to do so. It wasn't our meeting. We were there to talk about our part of the budget, not the rest of the budget. In terms of what is here and what is highlighted, the interesting thing for me, I have to raise this just because the HVAC at the middle school auditorium is a big ticket item on here in relation to some of the others. And everyone will agree that having air condition is oftentimes seen as a want versus a need. But what I need to also remind us of is that last year at town meeting, everyone voted for it. Now, we didn't know at the time it was going to cost more than what was appropriated at the time, but the town did say, you're right, let's pay for it. Now, would they have made a different decision if the price had been different? Maybe. But we're not even, if we take it off at this point, we don't even give them the opportunity to make that decision.
And I think that's, sorry to interrupt, I think that is a clear point and clearly a point of divergence that we have with some other boards in town, is that we did go back and get a new number, and the right thing to do is to give town meeting the opportunity to see the revised number and make the decision. town meeting is the body that approves these appropriations. And so by us saying, well, the town voted for it last year, but now it's more expensive, so let's take it off, I think we're subverting town meeting. So I agree with everything you're saying. Sorry, I just wanted to.
No, that's fine. I mean, I appreciate that. I mean, in looking at the other highlighted items, there's really, honestly, only one of the highlights on here that I even think is worth taking off, strictly on the standpoint that we have no, it's the storage facility. And the reasoning behind my thought process on that is that we haven't identified a spot for it, and we also likely will have a new director of buildings and grounds, and my thought process being, well, wouldn't it be better to have them involved in the process of choosing that and determining that? And so if there was something on here that I was like, yeah, you know, it's kind of a strange year for that, mm-hmm. that's my opinion on it. But, you know, from the buildings and ground equipment system wide, we heard some horror stories this year of some of the equipment that is being used system wide for the district and buildings and grounds. And none of that had been brought to anyone's attention before. So obviously we would have worked to rectify it earlier. But, and in addition, the paving situation, those are both things that I think snowball after you haven't taken care of them at a time that was appropriate and could be potentially more expensive. So I, you know, at first I was really on the fence about the middle school HVAC piece, and then when I thought more about the fact that we had all voted for it last year, I became a little confused as to why me as one person on a committee would make that decision for the town when the town had already decided otherwise. And when looking at the other four highlighted items, the other three highlighted items, my personal opinion is of those four total, the only one that, if I was willing to make any decision tonight, that I would be willing to take off would be the storage facility. Now, again, I agree with all of my colleagues here that I don't think we've been given a clear understanding of why we'd be taking any of them off, and I happily would fall on that side of the coin as well, because the message does keep changing. And because we have had a rigorous evaluation process in even putting any items onto these capital requests and also planning them out for the years to come, that we're messing with our plan without clear information. And yet, you know, the question was coming up on Tuesday night about Elmwood School and why is it in some, is it really in disrepair, and, you know, all these questions. And I'm like, you realize that these things have snowballed as time's gone on, as they've gotten pushed out, and we can't afford it this time. And I think the other important piece that came up on Tuesday night is, yes, the income of the town is not always going to be what it is in these last few years and in this year. But then, to me, if we keep pushing out some of these things, then we're going to be in a scenario where there's even less income for the town, and then what are we continuing to push them out? So I just don't feel like I've been given enough information or enough convincing information that would solidify a reasoning for me to change what we had already thought so diligently about earlier this year. And in addition, you know, if I was at all to make any thought process change on any of the 10, it would only be for the storage facility at this point.
To your point, Lori, I think, you know, one thing, you know, I thought we left that meeting with an agreement and an understanding that we were going to look for about half of $454,000 in our operating and pay-as-you-go items. But also that we asked for information about how all of the changes that were made in the context of the meeting that we were part of affected the projections for the next several years, so that we could make an informed decision about the impact of pushing some of these out. Because, as we all discussed at that meeting, that's partly how we arrived at this situation, because we had some very difficult budget years and were forced to push some things out, and things snowball, to your point. So we didn't receive that information. It's my understanding that after we left, they also changed other factors that would greatly impact by introducing an underwrite that we didn't discuss. That was in the actions taken document that was published today by Town Hall. That will greatly impact what the ability is of the town to pay for things in future years. So I'm even less comfortable having this conversation now, because not only did we not get the information that we asked for, it has dramatically changed the model that our entire conversation was predicated on. The financial information that we were sent just prior to this meeting has changed the percentage of the total budget allocated to the schools from 55.64% on Tuesday to 72.75% today. I have no understanding or explanation as to how that has happened. Many of the numbers that they had on our capital spreadsheet were incorrect, despite our having corrected them several times. I want to be very clear, and I want to take a minute to sincerely thank Mr. Herr for trying to keep everybody all on the same page and for voting against some of what happened after we left the meeting. I really have appreciated his collaborative approach with the schools this year, and I want to make sure that we note that, because we clearly are all quite frustrated at this point. But I feel like this is not authentic, or this is not following the charter process. This is undermining the rights and responsibilities of the Appropriations Committee, the Capital Improvements Committee, the School Committee. And I mean, I don't see any way in which this is serving the town. You know, I think this has reached a critical point. These boards have got to all come together. We have to all come together, have one common conversation, make some common understandings, and actually stick to them with integrity and move forward in this process. I applaud their concern regarding the unusual spike in taxes. I agree with all of you that people voted on it and should expect it. That doesn't mean it isn't a hard pill to swallow, and I understand that. And I want to be very clear that I am absolutely committed to playing our part. But I just, you know, I said it before, and I guess I don't have anything other than to say again, then this is just too confusing, and I just don't understand what keeps changing, and I have no way to predict what's going to change tomorrow, and we cannot make a different decision in that not atmosphere, scenario, whatever situation.
So I guess at this time I'm not hearing anyone compelled to make any changes at this time. If we're not, then there's no action to be taken. If I'm hearing incorrectly, let me know. But otherwise, then I would say that we've discussed it as much as we possibly can. There's no need for us to keep reiterating the frustration. I do fully agree with you, Jean. You know, I don't have any lack of commitment on helping the town achieve a fair budget for all of its constituents, but at the same time, in light of the ever-changing tides that come with the numbers, I'm not willing to change a decision that was based on the facts we had before us at the time, and my understanding of the situation of the needs of the school district at the time and the needs of the students.
So going forward, I mean, what is our next step? Are we going to communicate back that while we're willing to consider this, we need more information and we're not able to make a decision at this point? Or we're willing to continue the conversation? Or
that's a really good point. I mean, I mean, I certainly don't want the sole responsibility as to what that communication would be, nor do I at all intend that to be your responsibility, Dr. McLeod. So if there, it would probably be the best for us to discuss that now as to what the communication is, so that we're all on the same page and clear as to how we will communicate back to the Board of Selectmen and the town manager as to what our decision was at this time.
Because I do want to be very clear that we are absolutely willing to collaborate with our partners. Very clear on that. I feel like that is not what has happened, and we can't continue to operate in a vacuum.
I completely agree with that. We're willing to collaborate. We recognize the uniqueness of this year, and we want to do what is most responsible for the taxpayers of the town. I think the other thing to highlight, Gene, that you highlighted so well, is I think the key piece to this is based on the, I mean, there's a whole bunch of words I can use, amount, variety, but based on the information we have received subsequent to our departure from that joint meeting on Tuesday, we do not feel that we have I'm going to be repetitive again, but we don't feel that we have the information that would compel us to feel like it's responsible to make any changes to the budget or capital requests that we have already gone through an exhaustive review of. You're going to work on sentence construction, right?
Well, let me tell you that shorthand is not my strong point, so I'm trying to furiously write, and we'll see where we come out. But I mean, this needs to be precise, and it needs to be clear that this is not a disobedient child speaking back to the Board of Selectmen. This is a committee that has its own fiduciary responsibilities and its own legal requirements to the town as well. And so, you know, we need to be clear that, you know, while we are more than willing to be collaborative in the absence of compelling and accurate information, we're unable to make a decision.
Well, I mean, maybe we can just say that we're committed to continuing to collaborate with the Board of Selectmen, the Appropriations Committee, and the Capital Improvements Committee, but giving the dramatic changes in the financial information provided and the requests being made, we would appreciate the opportunity to have a joint meeting to discuss all of this together, operating from a common set of financial forecast. You look like you have something better than that.
The only
to
thing
say.
I wanted to say, referring to the actions taken at the Board of Selectmen meeting the other night, I looked at that too. And the motion actually, or the action, was that the Board of Selectmen referred the budget to the Appropriations Committee with the target of removing $545,000 from the operating and pay as you go capital budgets. So it seems to me that the Board of Selectmen has already moved that budget along to AC, so that may be where you want to address your letter to.
It is, but if you read further, then they took another action to put an underwrite on the
ballot.
Yeah,
I do know that. Yeah.
And to prevent or to remove our placeholder ballot question for the artificial turf fields.
Did we already do an underwrite?
Yes,
we did.
But again, the way they've set up this budget right now, I think this is important for everyone who might be watching or who will subsequently watch this. The way they have set up this budget right now, it would create an untaxed levy for next year of well over $3 million. So what I believe they're trying to do with the underride is essentially eliminate that untaxed levy now.
Which is why it changes dramatically the forecast for FY 19 and 20 that we're being asked to push some of our capital articles over to.
I think it's an important discussion to have about the last underwrite and what that actually did and how new growth and free cash helped this out in a big way.
I also feel like the process is being subverted in a really disturbing way. I feel like we were there for 3 hours. They had our undivided attention on items that significantly impact us. One of the members had said something to the effect of that felt like we had slapped them in the face. This feels like an enormous slap in our face, that they are trying to subvert what is the process that's been established at the 11th hour, in a way that does not feel collaborative. It does not feel responsible. It does not feel like it is taking into account what all the people want. They're not giving people, the residents, the taxpayers, the opportunity to weigh in on these things in the way that they're intended to hear the presentations, to hear the, they were offered the opportunity to have the Fields Subcommittee present to them the information that they have. I don't know what the recommendation is because I know it hasn't come out. I feel like an enormous process was just chopped right off, and people for whom this was really important are not being allowed to have their voice.
My comment in listening to all of you tonight is that there was a tremendous loss of trust that happened on Tuesday night amongst all of us, and there needs to be some time for rebuilding. You have been consistently working from a place of being transparent, and when I listened to you answering the questions, giving all of the information you had, providing information that was not on the agenda, that we were not there to answer to, but doing it willingly instead in a way of educating, coming from a place of truly trying to educate because that's what you thought they wanted, and then to be treated in the way that you were, I just think that there was in that room a lot of work that has taken place over the years to build collaboration and trust was lost, and you don't get that back. You need to earn that back. So that's my comment for what it's worth, to add to the conversation.
I do think, Nancy, I would, one thing I really want to pile on what you said too is again, I think it's important to say that we're not even talking about the collaboration and the process with the six of us here at this table. What happened on Tuesday night actually served to undermine the process of town meeting. Yeah. They right. served to prevent right. the town from being able to assess and decide on projects that they may or may not, and also inferred intent of the town on projects previously approved. That's the part, as part of our yeah. responsibility to the citizens of the town, that's the part that bothers me most.
Right.
And I think it's quite frankly troubling. And I do agree with what Mrs. Birchman said in terms of the communication to the Board of Selectmen, that I think we do need to have a joint meeting where all of this can be on the table and be hashed out, because what's happening right now is, I think you used the word and it's true, it's disturbing.
And I don't think it should be anybody being invited to anybody else's meeting. I think that was the other clear distinction of power. I think it should be a joint meeting that all three committees are yep. participating in equally.
So back in the day, we have at least the first year or 2 years that I was on the committee, again, which were the horrible years of just no money and a bad economy. We had a joint meeting at the fire station on a Saturday so that, you know, we had a lot of undivided time. We had everyone in the room. I hate to say, we did have the finance directors, the town manager, and the superintendent, and that's a lot to ask from our staff as well, but all members of the Board of Selectmen, the School Committee, the Appropriations Committee, and the Capital Improvements Committee, because, and it worked very well. The four groups worked collaboratively off the same set of numbers, we were able all to make our individual votes that were required at the time. We were all able to stay in our lane, but see what was happening in other lanes. And just, you know, I've said more times than any of you can probably count, it's frustrating to work in a vacuum. I felt like so.
That's a great idea.
Sorry, I'm desperately to come up with something because I have no opportunity to send anything out for you all to comment on it, and I do think it's important that we have a timely response, because if there's anything that I am most proud of with this committee is that we have stuck to our commitments on the timelines that were asked. We moved up timelines that we were not required to do so, and I have no intention of us lowering ourselves in our collaboration level and willingness, as well as our ability to be timely in our response. So I want this to be, I want us to continue that, because I mean, it's something that we all are proud of, and it's all, it's something that we also all sacrifice an immense amount of time for. It may seem like it goes unnoticed, but I mean, there are people that know how much time this takes and appreciate it, and I don't want us to change our methodology and how well we've worked together over the years, and just because we're angry at how the process has come to this point. So far, I don't have an end. That's my problem. So based on what you all were saying, this is what I've come up with so far, and please know that I'm not good doing this on the fly. The school committee is committed to continuing the budget discussions with the Board of Selectmen, the Appropriations Committee, and the Capital Improvements Committee. However, due to the fact that dramatic changes were made in the time that from when the school committee departed the Board of Selectmen meeting until, I don't know, and this is where I'm at.
Publication of the actions taken or something.
Maybe.
Right.
Just put in the just date
until,
of the meeting,
I would
maybe,
say, or? Even just until our discussion tonight.
Yes.
Because
okay,
that's, I mean, we've had.
Yeah. From, but maybe
it's stuff
the dates,
in.
Like from February 28th.
Because it seems like some of it happened outside. It must have happened outside of their meeting.
But also, I would include the appropriations in that. Because, you know, this isn't just that we're pouty.
No, they didn't have the opportunity either, because they also
I have them
departed.
In here.
Okay. I meant in that sentence.
Oh, okay. Oh, you mean the departed the Board of Selectmen and appropriate joint meeting?
I would just say, since the conclusion of the joint meeting between the three. While you're drafting, I will take this opportunity to say, in relation to the charter, while I feel that there are some things that are not happening in line with the charter right now, it's important to remember that in the next budget cycle, assuming it passes it at the ballot, we will be operating under our new charter, which specifies that the budget timeline will be set up with the agreement of the Board of Selectmen, the School Committee, and the Appropriations Committee. And you know, we're all upset right now, and time will pass, but I think it's important that we, as we are going through this, we all be taking notes to ourselves about how we can work together to improve this process and set it up for better success from the beginning next year, because we will have more of a voice in that than we have had in the past. And I think, you know, the upside of the challenge that we're facing right now is that we're learning some things that don't work for us, and that we would like to recommend not happen again. So just, you know, put that out there while Lori's writing, that we should all sort of be taking some mental notes at this point.
Yeah, I mean, the only thing I would say to that is that I haven't been chair for these past few years. This is my first foray into this world. But I do know that, you know, Dr. McLeod and the past chairs have made significant effort to engage in continuous conversation, you know, and to change the way that that timeline is worked with the town. And yet I feel like deja vu here, you know, we're here again, although this feels quite a bit different. And also I think that adds to the disappointment level because of the fact that we had had these monthly meetings with the chair of the Board of Selectmen and with the town manager and the finance director and the appropriations committee all along. And even when a meeting was missed, we had asked for the meetings to resume. So it makes it all the more frustrating, but I don't disagree with you, Jean, that should be an ongoing goal and thought process going into each cycle. It's just that it feels, there's a sense of futility there.
Well, so the change is that in the current charter, the town manager sets the schedule, and in the upcoming charter, it's needs to be agreed on by all three groups prior to it starting. So we do have more of a voice and a role. So I'm hopeful that we can, you know, be productive with that new opportunity.
Okay, so I have the dates and all the parties included. The question I have is, so we're saying that however due to the fact that there's been these dramatic changes, probably, you know, that we left the meeting, we're now resumed our conversation at our meeting, what's our conclusion?
I think something about, did you put in the idea of the joint meeting?
Not yet.
Because I would say something like we look forward to continuing the discussion and would suggest a joint meeting between the three committees. Should we include CIC?
Yes.
So four committees, including CIC, so that we can reach common conclusions.
And I would just, I think that's perfect, except I would strengthen suggest to request.
Fair enough. Yep.
All right. But the problem is this, is that we have so far stated that, you know, we're committed. We feel that there's been dramatic changes. Because of those dramatic changes, what are we saying? We are not giving you, we are unable to make any additional recommendations,
we are not prepared.
Oh, yeah, that's an important point.
We are not prepared to make.
We don't have the information we need.
Yep. We're not prepared to make any changes to our, to the current approved budget and capital requests from the school.
Yeah, I think we are not prepared to make any changes to
the current budget requests.
The current budget request already submitted.
And then you make the suggestion about the meeting.
I think it's important to get capital in there too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, budget, we said yes.
So now what you're saying, John, is we look forward to
I think what Ralph meant is say budget and capital,
budget and
not
capital,
just budget,
yeah,
right?
Budget and capital, right.
I think that's
where
when you
we are not prepared to make any changes to the current
budget and capital
budget and capital requests already submitted. I'm actually going to put already timely submitted.
I would say at this time.
And we are not prepared at this time.
Yeah.
Far more kind than I am, Nancy.
Well,
currently already submitted capital, what is it? Capital what?
Capital requests?
Requests. Yeah, requests. Capital requests.
All right. So what is it that we're asking? So we can't demand.
We can request.
We're requesting a meeting.
A joint meeting.
A joint meeting with those other bodies and
all four
in the near future. As I mean, this is obviously pressing as we're marching forward.
Yeah
So the way I think I would write it was, we respectfully request a joint meeting with the four
or to include, does that work,
to include
the four required committees in order to
jointly
well, we're looking to like rectify the confusion or something along that line. You know what I mean? Like,
cause we're just not to seek some clarity.
We're not promising anything. We're just asking for
consistency and clarity.
Yeah.
It.
the words I wrote down earlier that you said were compelling and accurate information, whoever said those words. I thought they were good.
Okay, so how about this? In order to achieve, I don't know, something along those lines. What was it? Compelling?
Compelling and accurate. Those are the two things that are missing.
In order to be provided with compelling and accurate information to inform our decision-making.
Excellent.
And we'd compelling. Be happy to host it.
And Ralph wants to arrange the hosting and the
we can host
the refreshments.
Oh.
that would be great.
Brunch at your house?
You're good at music too, Ralph.
Yeah.
And accurate information.
So
it'd be better if we hosted it
to inform our decision making.
And I think, you know, I said before we've done it on Saturdays. That doesn't work for everybody either. So I think we need to be willing to be flexible if we can do. You know,
an evening.
If an evening, but start early, and maybe we can bring pizza.
We have a half day coming up. We could an afternoon.
Except the amount of time I've taken off from work already for the finance.
I want to be respectful of people's work schedules, but also their family time. So, we don't have to pick a date right now. But because I said Saturday doesn't mean we have to insist on
doodle
Saturday.
Poll. We could put out a doodle poll and
sure. Yeah, but that's true. We need to. Like, that's kind of.
We don't need that much detail right here.
No.
Right, I agree.
So let me give the gist, because I'm obviously not going to change our overall tenor. I might have to play with
words.
The wording a little bit. So the school committee is committed to continuing the budget discussions with the Board of Selectmen, the Appropriations Committee, and the Capital Improvements Committee. However, due to the fact that dramatic changes were made in the time the school committee departed, the joint meeting between the Board of Selectmen, the School Committee, and the Appropriations Committee on February 28th, and the time that the School Committee resumed our discussions about the budget and the capital request at our March 2nd, 2017 meeting, we are not prepared at this time to make changes to the already timely submitted budget and capital requests. We respectfully request a joint meeting with the four, and I just wrote four required committees, I'll write them in order to be provided with both compelling and accurate information to inform our future decision making.
That's good. One suggestion I popped into my head is where it says, the sentence starts with due to the fact early on. Mm-hmm. The dramatic, I would change it.
However, due to the fact.
I would say due to the dramatic changes made after we departed.
Yeah. And
that's my lawyer coming in, so thank you. Due to the dramatic, great.
And I would just say instead of after the school committee departed, because appropriations left then too, just say after the conclusion of the joint meeting.
Okay.
It's more streamlined. And, it's my expectation, again, Mr. Herr has been really collaborative throughout this process. I would expect that he would be open to this. I think we've all reached a level of frustration, and that's unfortunate. But at the end of the day, all four boards want the same thing. We seem to be going about it at different ways this year. So I really do think we're at a point where if this is either going to escalate and be less productive, or we can all come together and work together. And I have no doubt we can come out with a good result, but.
So is the intent that I am sending this via email or letter?
I would do both. I'm just in the timely.
Okay, I have no problem with that. I'm just asking.
What do others think?
I'm just wondering how the letters would get to people.
Yeah, I would just send an email.
If you want to send it to me, I can work with Megan to make sure it gets to everybody.
They didn't receive the correspondence that we had mailed to them before that planning board.
Received it.
Okay.
Yes, they just hadn't.
It's kind of like that. Email would be maybe. Check your mailboxes and. All that jazz or whatever. So, okay, email it is. I have no problem with email. It's not like we're providing legal notice. We're just responding. Okay, are you trusting that I will wordsmith it?
Full faith and confidence.
I think that's well within your...
You'll all be copied on it, so it won't be in a vacuum. All right, so I will commit to having this sent out tomorrow.
Okay.
And we'll make sure that, and I think, I mean, I probably, I don't know if maybe you can even end it by saying, you know, please have the chairs of each committee pull their committee members with appropriate scheduling or something like that. So my understanding would be that we would have the Board of Selectmen, the Appropriations Committee, the Capital Improvements Committee, and the School Committee on this correspondence. Or are we just responding to the Board of Selectmen?
That's a good question.
But if we're inviting all four of the groups to get together, well, I think it should be everybody.
I think, so the question is, are we calling a budget meeting? Because it's a little outside of our purview, I think, to do that. So if what we are requesting is for the Board of Selectmen to do that, then I think we should send this to them and say, this is what we would really, this is our preferred next step. They may, I'm very hopeful that they'll agree. If they don't, then there isn't any reason to have escalated the drama with other departments. Tonight, so.
Okay.
So I think we should just request that they.
All right, we'll do. All right, so it's to the Board of Selectmen. So the Board of Selectmen, the town manager, and us and Dr. McLeod will be on the email.
Okay.
All right. So that item went a little over in time. So our next discussion is on the turf field design request for qualification that I know, Jane, you were going to speak to.
Yes. So at our last meeting on Monday, Ralph and John and one of our committee members prepared an RFQ for the design of phase one of the athletic field project. So you'll remember that when Gale Associates came and gave you the presentation of the feasibility study, what the subcommittee is looking at right now is a phased approach so that we can maximize the investment that we've already made in the track, and so that we can start with a phase of the project that would maximize increased opportunity for practice and games for our own student athletes, but in addition for rental revenue across the town. And so so we have identified through our revenue from the BAA that we have the money available to pay for the design phase, so we will not be asking the town for additional monies. So that means that we have the ability to proceed forward now. And Ralph met with the subcommittee and did explain that technically it is not a requirement that we issue an RFP or that the school committee do it, but we all felt really strongly that in terms of transparency and having the public be able to access all of this information if they would like to, we wanted to do it that way. So we asked Ralph and John and one other member of our subcommittee who actually does this for a living, builds turf fields for colleges and really knowledgeable guy. Anyway, so they put this together, the subcommittee reviewed it, and at the meeting on Monday voted to recommend to the school committee that Ralph issue this on behalf of the district. So that is sort of the background around the RFP. What I want to say additionally is that, as you remember, we had some conversation about this on Tuesday with the Board of Selectmen, and there was concern, obviously, around adding to the FY18 tax bills. Even if we kept this, as I explained at that time, even if we kept this on the warrant for the May 17 meeting, it wouldn't add to the FY18 tax bill because we wouldn't break ground until May or June of 2018. But recognizing the strong feelings, we did agree to continue looking at this and consider postponing the request for a year. I don't think anyone's ready to make that decision, but the reason I'm bringing it up now is that it should not affect starting the design phase. it just, you know, there's no reason not to start the design now, whether we go forward this May or next May, but it just gives us an opportunity to fully flesh out what the request is going to be and have a really solid presentation for a town meeting whichever year that comes. So that might be more than you were looking for, but I think that's a comprehensive.
Can I add a comment? I think it also maintains the momentum of the committee that's been working really hard since the beginning of the year and have felt really passionate about their work. And I think at least getting through design and knowing what the dollars really are, and it would be important to the committee.
Yes. Thank you.
And I think to the public interest that it has generated, the forum was very well attended.
Yep.
And I know that there were people that were watched the presentation online that weren't able to be there. So I think on behalf of the people that have been behind it to pursue it, to we have a more knowledge, seems appropriate.
My only question you've already answered, which was, you know, in the event that this doesn't move forward for this town meeting, would this still make sense to have at this time? But it appears that it would, because it also, like, I think it's very hard to inform the public if we don't have more information. And so we're kind of in a catch-22 if we don't move forward with this. So.
Well, the other opportunity that it brings is that we have been in communications with the CPC committee, and they actually are meeting tonight, so we were not able to attend their meeting, but they have agreed. Their cycle is in the fall, and we didn't have enough detail in the fall to go to them to apply for funding. They did offset some of the costs of the Fruit Street fields, and so they're are certain parameters under which they are able to contribute money towards a project like this. It doesn't mean they're required to, and they may not for whatever reason, but starting the design phase now also gives us an opportunity to meet with them, understand what the elements are, their criteria that they use to evaluate, and make sure that as we're doing design that we're cognizant of that, so that when we go to them in the fall, hopefully we will be successful, or we will put our best foot forward, whether again they decide to fund us or not is entirely at their discretion. But that's the other reason I think it's really important to keep moving forward.
So
can I also just mention that there's also an underlying tactical piece to this as well, which is that when we did the original we've done the original assessment work this past summer, I guess, we had engaged with two different engineering firms, and one of the things the committee keeps sort of butting up against is when we're thinking about different things, we have questions that are appropriate for one of the engineering firms.
Right.
And we need to pick one, because we can't keep going back to one or the other and say, and it may not be one of those two, but we need to have a resource that we can go to, and it's not fair to the two that are now past the scope of the work that they had originally performed for us to continue to answer a lot of those questions. So that's another reason why it's important to keep this moving forward, to keep the momentum of the committee.
Actually, it can only be one of those two.
Oh, okay. All right. Sorry.
We did specify that in here.
Oh, we did? Okay,
just because they've done feasibility.
I like them both. Yeah.
So my question is actually, and forgive me for not asking this earlier because it's been brought up in a couple meetings, but it just didn't seem appropriate to ask at the time, so I'm going to ask the stupid question now. But CPC, is that a state agency or a town?
Actually, I have been in contact with the state agency to verify that it is something that our town committee could consider. So CPC money comes out of your taxes, and it's a state matching program. And so a certain percentage of our taxes automatically go into the CPC fund every year, and the state matches up to some percent, and it probably changes every year. But so there is money there, and so, you know, when the fruit, but there also are restrictions on it. And so, for example, they actually cannot pay for synthetic turf. So at Fruit Street, they paid for the groundwork, and the Youth Soccer Commission paid for the actual turf. So, you know, there's no possibility that they could pay for the entire project. I don't think they have that much money anyway. But there should be some pieces of the project that they are, that's within their purview to contribute towards, again, whether they choose to or not is entirely, but they also fund things, you know, historical things, recreation things. Originally, they were only able to fund passive recreation, and that was a change that was made along the way at town meeting to say passive and active, and that was how they were then able to contribute to the Fruit Street fields. So long-winded answer, but
no, it's good. I just didn't. It's been mentioned a few times in my presence, and I just have never asked the question to understand what it actually
is. I mean, basically, so it's money that's already come out of our taxes, and so rather than re-tax people again for something that could be covered by what they've already contributed, it would be nice if there could be an offset.
Any other questions or points of discussion? All right. Then I would seek a motion to recommend the request for qualification for the design of the fields as outlined in the agenda materials.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Cavanaugh, seconded by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And it's unanimous and so carries. And at this time, we have our second opportunity for public comment, and there is no one here other than our lovely HCAM. And so we'll move on to items by consensus. Dr. McLeod. Oh, sorry. I always forget to do this. Anyone have any items they want to take out of the items by consensus? Okay. Thank you.
The superintendent recommends the school committee move to approve the items by consensus as outlined below.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Cavanaugh, seconded by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, and it's unanimous and so carries. And at this time, I would seek a motion to adjourn at 8:35.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Graziano, seconded by Mrs. Cavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. And it's unanimous and so carries. Our next meeting, as we stated earlier, will be Tuesday, March 14th, 2017. Wow, a little few hours right here.
Oh, boy.
at 6 p.m. in the high school library, this will be a special meeting of the school committee to conduct interviews of our finalists for the Director of Finance and Operations position. And then our next regular meeting is scheduled for March 16th here at 7 p.m. in the high school library. Thank you and good night.
Thank you.